All right, welcome everyone to Truth Baptist Church Wednesday night service. I trust everybody will get right back on there here in a minute. We're going to be on page 222, day by day. Page 222, day by day. All right, page 222, day by day.
Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to be my trials dear. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure, gives unto each day what he deems best. Lovingly, it's part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Every day, the Lord himself is near me, with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me, he whose name is Counselor and Power. The protection of his child and treasure is a charge that on himself he laid. As thy days, thy strength shall be in measure, this the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith, sweet consolation, offered me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meeting, there to take us from our Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land.
Amen. Now page 335, standing on the promises. So you probably ought not be sitting on the premises. You probably ought to stand up, although you can not do it and I'll never know. So, all right. And somebody can be picking another song, hopefully, by the time this one ends. Standing on the promises. That don't sound right.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God my Savior, I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amen. Well, I see another song on there. Looks like who's got the next one? I better go with who's got the next one. Victory in Jesus, and then page 336. Matter of fact, we're close to 336. Let's sing it real quick, then we'll have just an announcement or two, then we'll sing Victory in Jesus, all right? Page 336, Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, He who died, heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash away my sin, let His little child come in. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me still, though I'm very weak and ill. From His shining throne on high, comes to watch me where I lie. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, He will stay close beside me all the way. If I love Him when I die, He will take me home on high. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Amen. We'll sing page 475 here in a minute. I want to thank y'all for getting involved and picking songs. And don't it feel good to be involved? Good job. I'm glad y'all picked things that I could play. That always makes it so much better. So, all right, let me adjust this view a little bit. All right, you may be seated if you're standing, and if you're not standing, you may not be seated. I'm just kidding. All right, not too many announcements right now. Continue to pray for everybody, each other, and about this virus thing and all of that. Everything that's going on, and just that God would keep everybody safe, and pray for everybody spiritually as well. That God will work, and that we'll all draw closer to Him and all that. And let's see, that's I haven't got too much going on today. Remember your offerings and all of that. I want to thank the Lord for this last month. We had $400 came in for our missions. Amen. You're doing a good job, Truth Baptist Church. We sure appreciate that. All right. Let's sing our last song, page 475, Victory in Jesus.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood.
Praise God!
He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood.
Praise God!
He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. Plunge me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. Some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood.
Praise God!
He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. Plunge me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
All right, you may get your Bibles out. Find our text verse, Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16. All right, now I'm taking a break from, honey, I think maybe we do need that light on. I'm taking a break from the spiritual weapons of our warfare for a little while. I've only really got one weapon to go, but I've got to do some studying on it and whatnot, and I figured y'all need a break anyways, and so I'm going to preach something different this evening. So let me get this started, and I think I'll be ready. All right, Proverbs chapter 24 and verse 16. The title of my message is "You Can't Keep a Good Man Down," and so the text verse, it says, "For a just man falleth seven times and riseth up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief." Let's pray and ask the Lord to join us here this evening. Our dear Father, We come to you and we just ask in the name of Jesus that you would bind Satan from every house and every place, anyone who's listening, including this place, and that you would loose everyone from any of the clutches of Satan or strongholds or interference or anything that would get in the way, that our minds may be clear and our eyes may be open and our ears open, that we may hear and see and that you may speak to us. And I pray that you deal in hearts and help us to respond to you. Bless this reading and message from thy word, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can't keep a good, a good man down. Now, we just read the verse, just man falls seven times and rises up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief. There's two kinds of people and that are mentioned here, the just and the wicked. There's only two kinds of people in the world, the just and the wicked, okay? And God doesn't mince words. He just speaks it straight, the just and the wicked, okay? And now there's several different terms used in the Bible that boil down to the same thing for each of these words, okay? But it comes down to just these two. Now, the word just, it's actually a word of the courts and the law and all of that. Just, or to do justice, or in this case, it literally means it's basically short for justified. Okay. And so if you're justified, that means you're saved. Okay. That means you're born again. That means that you're no longer guilty. Okay. Now, only God can do that. And if you've been justified, you've become a child of God, and you've been declared just, even though you're guilty, okay? And because Jesus Christ washes away the sins, okay, and he makes us righteous, giving us Christ righteousness, okay? And so when it says the word just, that's what we're talking about, a saved person. Let me get a drink here real quick. Okay. And so, but it has other meanings as well. The word just or righteous here means morally good. It means law-abiding, good in character, that kind of thing. Okay. In this passage, these things are true as far as being morally good and law-abiding and all of that business. These things are good as far as one of God's children, as long as we do it for him, okay? Because just means that you're saved, and to do good works in the name of Christ or for him, then it makes them really actually good works. Otherwise, we're just doing them for ourselves or whatever. But other words are used as well. Righteous is another word, the righteous. That means we're given Christ righteousness, okay? All your good deeds adds up to a big, fat zero, okay? They all add up to nothing. Good deeds done for salvation amounts up to nothing. You can't save yourself, right? Good deeds for the service of the Lord, they will all be burned up like wood, hay, and stubble. Unless you're saved and you're doing it in obedience and in service to the Lord. See, Christians can do sinful things or wrong things or right things for the wrong reason. So righteous or just, okay, means we're given his righteousness. If you get to heaven or do anything that survives the fire, okay, of your works, it'll be through his righteousness and not yours, not mine. Okay. Now, these are just words that mean the same thing as just. Okay. Here's another word means the same thing as just, perfect. The Bible talks about those who are perfect. Now, perfect is another word describing Christians. Christians is one of the words too, okay, in the Bible, a Christian. And these are just names of children of God but we're all going to narrow it down to just. Okay, here's another one. Believer is another word the Bible uses. saint. Did you know the Bible, the meanest, ungodliest, sinfulest saint person in the Bible or person in the world, God still calls him a saint. Okay? The most upstanding and righteous acting and religious and honest person in the world who doesn't know God, God calls him a sinner. Okay? And so so these are just some words, but we're going to use the word just because it's in this verse. The verse says, a just man falleth seven times, rise up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief. Okay? So the wicked is the other. Okay? So here's the word, the wicked. The wicked is anyone who's not in Christ, who's not saved. The most upright, religious, kind-hearted, law-abiding, neighborly man, woman, boy, or girl. God calls them wicked. Okay? No matter how good they are on the outside, if they know not him, they're wicked on the inside. They're a sinner on the inside, and God calls them wicked. Okay? Now, other terms for the wicked are sinner, fool, simple, unbeliever, okay? And they all amount to one word, which God used very directly, the word wicked. So there is the just or righteous, and then there's the wicked, okay? Now, simply put, God says here, the just are going to fall, but they're going to rise up again. The wicked are going to fall. That's very simple terms. Now let me say this about falling down. Okay? The falling ain't the worst thing. Okay? But staying on the ground is. Did you get that? Falling isn't the worst thing in the world, because we as Christians ought to rise back up again. We ought to get back up. But to fall and stay down there on the ground and not give up or not get up and not try again, well, that's a bad deal. We ought not do that. If you're a child of God, you ought not do that. Okay? Now, another note. Both in this verse, you'll notice both the just and the wicked, they both fall. Okay? All right? So think about that. So the falling isn't the worst thing. All right? But to stay down there, that's a bad thing, and that's what I'm speaking on tonight. Now, it's a race. It's a race that we're running, okay? It's not how you run the race as much as how you finish, okay? Jesus and Paul, both, their last words were to do with this. Jesus hung up around that cross, and he got to say, it is finished. It is done. Paul, a few days before they beheaded him, said, I have finished my course. And to finish is to slap Satan in the face. It's to get to spit in his face and say, you couldn't stop me. Okay? It's a glorious thing to get to say, I finished. So we ought to want to finish, and we ought to want to finish well. Okay? I tell you, I have been running this race for a while, right? I was saved when I was 9 years old, but I surrendered completely to the Lord when I was 22. And I've been running a while, but I ain't done yet. Amen. Okay? I want to finish well. Okay? I'm young. I'm only 49. And I'm thinking of staying there for the rest of my life, because 50s in a few weeks, okay? And so I may join like Brother Morgan and decide to stay there. I'll be more honest. I'll be 49 instead of 39. But I intend to finish well. I want to finish this race. I want to go until I can't go no more. I want to serve God and do the job he's called me to do until I'm done, okay? I don't plan on hitting 65 in 15 years and saying, well, it's time to retire. Now I can turn on the TV and get out the fishing pole and don't have to do nothing ever again, and I did my job. No, I'm going to run until I can't run no more, okay? Now, and so these things that I just mentioned, some of this is, these are the points that I want to make to the just in particular, to the righteous, to those who are saved. There's too many people that quit. That's the gist of my message tonight. There's too many castaways. There's too many casualties. Too many Christians who have given up or quit. All right? Many who think or say, it's too late for me. There's no hope. I tried and I failed. I got burned once and I ain't trying it again. There's too many downtrodden, offended, hurt, or hurting people. There's so many people that can't find one solid reason to go on for Christ. I'm just done. I quit. I tried. How horrible is it if you tried one time and it didn't work out and you quit? If that's the case with you, you need to get back up again and go again and start again. And if you fail, guess what? You're going to fall down and you're going to fall down. And you're going to fall down. But get back up again and go again. Right? Do it again. If you're one of those who have quit, let me ask you a few questions. Okay. How long have you been down there on the ground, wallowing in your misery? Has giving up solved your problems? Has it brought you satisfaction to your soul? Does it feel better sitting there watching other runners pass by? Does it feel better than it did when you were in the race running yourself? And even though you fell down at times, you was getting up and running the race. Does it feel better to just sit there on the sidelines? You say, I've messed up too bad. Show me a verse in this book. Okay? Show me anywhere in this book. Show me any sin that God won't forgive. There isn't one. Okay. Find my place. Totally lost my place. Okay. Show me in this book anyone that God won't restore and do a great work with. You'll let him do it. There's not one. Okay. But you say, but I'm disqualified. I've done the wrong sin and I've done the wrong thing and God can't use me anymore. Maybe you've been taught something wrong according to this book. Okay. It's a shame, really, that churches and religions and all of that are busy. It gets to me. And it's always bothered me. The churches are busy praying, God, send forth laborers into the harvest, for the harvest is, plenty and the laborers are few and we need more workers. And then people come along and surrender to the Lord. And the first thing we do is say, nope, you're not qualified. You're not qualified. You're not qualified. You're not qualified. Listen to me. If God called you and his gifts and callings are without repentance and he still has that burden on your heart, that means he's still calling you. It wouldn't be a fair God if he's still calling you and then saying, no, you're not qualified. See, got something wrong. You say, I'm not qualified. I just can't do it because whatever. Get back in there and find the truth. You find the truth and you'll find freedom. You'll find the place that God has for you. The place of fulfillment, the place of service that he has for you. He'll get you there. I guarantee you, anybody, it doesn't matter who you are, he will get you there if you're willing to say, I'm going to get up and go again for the Lord. You say, I've run out of hope. I have no reason to go again. I have no reason to try again. I'll give you a few reasons. Here's one. God said to. Amen. Hey, God said, get up and go again. I'll give you another reason. God has a plan for you, for your life. But it has one condition. Get up and get busy doing the work. Okay. And he'll help you work. He'll show you that plan and help you figure it out and get you where you need to be. Right. I got another reason for you to go again. Jesus didn't quit. Aren't you glad halfway up that hill, he didn't say, I've had enough. Y'all can all go to hell. I'm not doing this anymore. Aren't you glad? He didn't quit on you. Say, Pastor Randy, you're being awfully harsh. I'm trying to lovingly get you back in the race and help you to see that it ain't all about you. Have you noticed these things I've mentioned? They're not all about you. God didn't create you for you. If you've quit and you've given up and you feel sorry for yourself or whatever, and you feel down and all that, I understand it. I know where you come from, but you've got your mind and eyes on the wrong one. We're supposed to have our eyes on God, loving him, and other people loving them. Okay? So here's some reasons to not quit. All right? If you're saved, a good reason to not quit is that you get to run for him just to say thank you. You see, he didn't quit on you. If he didn't quit and he paid your way of salvation and he reached and got a hold of your heart sometime and brought you that place and he showed up and he was there and he saved you, then by George, at the least, if ain't no other reason, you ought to run the race. We ought to run the race, and we ought to run it, and we ought to do our best and get in there and keep doing it. If you go slow sometimes, fine. If you stumble and fall down, get back up and keep running it. And we ought to do it for him because he's done so much for us. I'll give you another reason. There's a great cloud of witnesses watching you run your race. Hebrews 12, verse 1 says, wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. See, there are those that aren't saved yet that are watching you and saying, please run your race and show me what a real Christian is. Convince me to be one. There are Christians out there that have quit also. That if you'd get up and start running, they're watching you, and they would probably get up and start running as well. Or you might get up and start running and let God work in your life until he does some things and until your life becomes a lot better. And then they may see you and say, wow, you know, maybe she's right. Maybe I'll go again. There's a great cloud of witnesses. Now, that's the main point I want to make for the Christians, but I want to make a point for the lost folks as well. First, anybody out there listening to me or ends up hearing this that isn't saved, God calls you the wicked. However good you may be, whatever good of a person you may be, God calls you wicked. Now, you're not even entered in the race. So no matter how well you think you run or how good you do, you can't win. You'll only eventually fall. And what a fall it will be. I'm going to get to that in a little bit. But you can run to find Jesus. You can seek him and search for him and find him when you search for him with all your heart. Jeremiah 29:13. So get entered. Get in there and find the Lord and get saved and become his child. Then he'll put you in the race and let you run. Okay? Now, my first point is this, and I got two main points, and it's the verse. First point is this, the just man falls seven times and rises up again. My second point is, but the wicked will fall into mischief. Okay? And so the just man, we talked about the just man a little bit while ago. Whether you're saved and serving God with all your heart, or whether you're saved and living selfishly, God still calls you a just man, a righteous man, a saved man. Okay? Job chapter 2, verse 3, the Bible said, and the Lord said to Satan, now get this, God brought it to Satan's attention, said, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? And still, now get this. This is chapter 2. Satan had already come in before the throne. God had already brought up Job one time. Said, "You consider my servant Job?" And he said, you've put a hedge of protection around him. Touch his family and his life and he'll curse you. And God said, okay, go ahead and do what you will, but you can't touch him. Okay. And so Satan went out and in one day took all his possessions and his belongings and his health and his family and touched every part of his life. Didn't touch his health yet. Touched his family and took everything that he had and devastated him. And then God said, Satan, this verse here is the second time God says, have you considered my servant Job? You've done all these things to him. Watch what he says in verse, the next part of that verse there. It says, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without a cause. Wow. What a great thing to have God say about you. Wouldn't you like for God to say, have you considered my servant? Put your name there. Have you considered my servant so-and-so? Considered my servant Truett? I know Truett's on here. Have you considered my servant Mitchell? Now that he's an upright man. Don't you want that kind of thing? Wouldn't you like for God to say something wonderful like that? Now, Job was a man that was saved and he was serving God, and God said, he is righteous. He's a good man. He's just. But now, there's another fellow I want to mention, a guy named Lot. Remember Lot? You read through the Bible and you can go in Genesis where you first find Lot and the story of Lot, and you'll find there was nothing but selfishness about that guy. You didn't find any one good thing about him. But there was one good thing about him. He had gotten saved, and he was a child of God. And I'm going to prove it to you. We don't find out until we get to 2 Peter chapter 2. Okay, verse 7 and 8. It says, and delivered just Lot. Now, you might say, oh, he's just saying he just delivered him, talking about him at that time. No, 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 no. It says delivered just, righteous, saved Lot. Now, I'm going to prove it to you. Okay? Delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. Verse 8 says, for that righteous man dwelling among them, in seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. You know what that means? Lot, in his selfish, sinful life, was saved. He made it to heaven. He was righteous in his soul, in his life. He didn't have anything righteous about him. He didn't do anything for the Lord that we know of. But he was saved. You see, if you're saved, God calls you the just. Now, that ought to bring comfort to some of those who may hear this, who have been saved but have never done anything for the Lord, or aren't serving God, or have quit and are sitting by the wayside and watching others run and saying, I ain't going to do it anymore, or I give up, or I'm not trying anymore, or I'm done, or I'm bitter, or I'm angry. It ought to give you a little consolation, to at least give you assurance. I know that I'm, but it ought to make you, if you're sitting by the sideline, I need to get up and go again. It's time I quit sitting here and I get back in the race. So whether you're sold out or sitting, if you're saved, you are the righteous. Now, the second part of that verse is this. Falls. The just man falleth. Okay? Now, you don't fall from grace. You don't fall from salvation. That isn't what it's saying at all. Once you're saved, you're saved. I just proved that. Okay? But you fall from fellowship with God. You'll fall from fellowship with other Christians if you get in sin. You'll fall into sin. You can fall into temptation. Okay? If you're saved, God upholds you with his hand. No man can pluck you out of his hand. I've heard people say, well, nobody else can pluck me out of my hand, but I get myself out of there. I could become, you know, I could lose my salvation. No, you can't. The God that saves you, he holds you in his hand and you can't even get yourself out. Okay? But to fall is a given. The Bible says it in this verse. The just man falls. Okay? The wicked falls too. We all are going to fall. We're going to stumble. We're going to trip sometimes. We're going to make a mistake. We're going to fall down. Okay? We all fall. It's even necessary. Did you know that? We need it. We must fall so we can learn to stand. Think of a little baby. Think of when you were a little baby. Do you remember that? Probably not. but you learn to stand and you fall, you fell down. Okay? Pretty soon you got to where you could stand. Then pretty soon you got to where you could walk. But you had to fall down to learn to not do that anymore and to not fall down anymore. Okay? So we learn, we do that so we can stand, so we can, then we can walk, and then we can run. Then we can run the race. Now, baby Christians always try to do good on their own. We've all done it. You finally get surrendered, or you get saved and you get excited about the Lord, okay? And so you go out rah, rah, gung ho, and you want to save the world. But we go in the flesh. We don't realize how much that we need God even more now that we're saved. Thus, we fall down. So falling is good for you because it teaches you that you can't trust in yourself. Did you know that? When you fall and mess up and fall and mess up, it teaches you you can't trust you, so that you're going to have to start trusting God. But no one likes falling. Does anybody like falling? Is it fun to fall down? Anybody? No. It ain't fun. It hurts usually. It hurts your body. It hurts your pride. You know, you're walking along, you know, with your integrity and your dignity, you know, and then you make some foolish mistake, trip over something and look like a, you know, clumsy whatever, falling, tumbling to the ground. You know, I think of the first 5 years that I was in Dulce, I think, the first several years anyways, no one laughed at a single one of my jokes. Okay, I would say something, I'd make a wisecrack or say something funny or whatever, but nobody, you know, them Indian kids there, they'd look at me like, I ain't laughing at you. But I'd go outside and I'd trip over something and fall down or bump my head on something. And, you know, I'd fall down and they'd fall down too, only they'd fall down laughing. I mean, they'd be rolling. They'd just be, that was so funny. You know how you Indian kids are. You know how you are. Okay. And, but it's funny to watch somebody else fall, but boy, we don't like it when it happens to us. Okay. So fall if you must, but get back. Get up and go again. Let the fall teach you something so that you can be stronger and last longer and not fall as often or by the same thing next time. It's why counseling, by the way, when I counsel people, it's why it will work if you work it. Okay. It's why I don't judge you when you mess up. Okay. I don't. All right. I just hope you'll keep at it. I hope you'll come back. I hope you'll be back there next week, saying, oh, I messed up, and can you help me out? And I say, sure, I'd like to. And we work on it again, and I hope that you'll work on it week after week. In fact, that's what repentance is. Did you know that? You fall into sin or temptation, okay? You rise again by repentance. You find mercy with God, and then you try again. And then you fall again. And you repent again, and you rise again, and you find God's mercy again, and you get going again. Think of this. Even the giving up is a sin. If you've quit, if you've given up, if you've stopped running the race, if you said, I ain't doing this no more, that's a sin. That may be the first thing you need to repent of. It may be that you need to say, you know what? I've been sitting here too long. God, I'm sorry that I quit. Please forgive me for this. help me get back up and get in the race again. Repent of that and let's try it again. Okay? In counseling, in church, if you'll stay with it, stay at it, keep coming, keep coming, keep coming, keep trying, keep working on it, keep trying, keep working on it. I don't care if it's 6 weeks, 6 months, or 6 years. You keep working on it. And sooner or later, you'll win. You'll start to win. You'll start to overcome. You'll start to blossom and bloom and grow and get stronger like you never thought possible. And you'd say, well, I don't know if I can handle it for 6 years. You want to go through six more years of sitting on the sideline, feeling bad and guilty and miserable? Get busy trying. Get busy at it. So the just man falls, the next thing is this, seven times. Okay, now, of course, God's number of completion is seven. To complete something is to finish it. Amen. Okay? Now, this number might as well be 70 or 700 for that matter. You know why? Because the Bible says God uses his number of completion because he wants to completely free you from that thing. He wants completely to get you in all the way. He wants completely help you overcome your sins. Okay? And so God, it might as well be 70 or whatever, because God is simply saying, keep getting up no matter how many times it takes, no matter how many times you fall down. Get up till you're completely done falling. At least in that area. You may have several areas in your life that are weak or that you fall and stumble and mess up on, but you keep getting up in all of them as much as you can. And pretty soon there'll be one of them that it ain't a weak area anymore and you won't fall anymore. Then you can keep getting busy working on the rest of them. Okay? And so keep it up until you finish. There's no glory in giving up. Did you know that? There's not one ounce of glory in quitting. Not any. None. So don't stop getting up. Just keep getting up again and going again. Get up again and go again. Get up again and go again. And if you've stopped, if you quit and haven't run in years, talking to Christians now, then guess what? If you're still breathing, you can still get up again and get back in there and go again. Again. So the just man falls seven times. And the last part of this point is this, and rises up again. See, he rises up again. They told me all through elementary school and all through high school that I'd never do anything worth anything, that I was worthless. I'm pretty sure that at least one soul is going to be in heaven because of me. Okay? I'm all right with that. If I don't do anything else, if I haven't done anything else in my life, then at least I made a difference in one soul's eternity. If I can help another soul, if I can help one more before I die, then I'm going to keep going until. In Bible college, they said, you won't last 6 months in the ministry if you quit college, if you don't come back. Well, that was 27 years ago. So far, so good. Amen. Okay. In Oklahoma, church I was in there, I surrendered to preach where I grew up. They said that I wasn't qualified to preach. You know what I said? I told them, you didn't call me to preach. And you ain't going to stop me from preaching. Amen! Satan told me when I was in Dulce in 2006, God don't care for you. You've been here at this all this time and it just keeps getting worse. He won't even let you win a ball game as a coach. Now, it took me a while. And I struggled, and I gave up for a little while. Finally, I got up and said, Lord, I'm going to trust you one more time. Do you know that was the decision moment that would have changed everything if I'd have made a different decision? That's when I finally got the victory in so many areas in my life. I mean, in the ball team, we won the championship the next year. Several people were saved. The whole town, you know, of Dulce recognized what was going on over there and some things happening. And God did some things in that next year that finally settled some things in my soul that I've been striving for a long time. Fixed it. Amen. Satan didn't win and I didn't quit. Now, believe me, I know it's hard. There's nobody that's wanted to quit any more than I have. It sure be easy to quit. Sometimes when the going gets tough, you want to get going. I start to say the tough, but I don't think I'm all that tough. So I didn't want to, you know, say that. But I wanted to get going. I wanted to quit. I wanted to stop. You don't know how many times. There was times I wanted to quit every day for months. I understand it's hard, but there's no glory in quitting. There's none. There's no peace. There's no rest in quitting. Okay? There's no joy. You can quit and sit there and say, well, I don't even have to do anything. I don't have to try. I don't have to make an effort. That's too much work. But there ain't no joy in it. The Bible says in Proverbs, weeping may, or Psalms or Proverbs says, weeping may be for a night. And sometimes it's a long night. But joy comes in the morning. Don't quit. Joy comes in the morning. It won't ever come if you quit. It'll be even a longer night. Now, it says, the just shall rise. Okay? You say, but what about the Christians who never try again? What about those who get saved and they give up and don't try and they live for themselves and they don't do anything for God all the way and they stubbornly stick with it all the way until they die, all the way until the end. Wouldn't that verse be a lie if that was true? No, because get this. It says the just are going to rise. Okay? The Bible is still true. Ultimately, all the just will rise in the resurrection. Amen. So even if you quit in this life and you go to the end and you don't get any victories, you don't get any rewards, and when you get to heaven, you ain't gonna get much rewards up there either, if any. You will get to rise up from the grave or in the clouds, get to heaven. Okay, so the just falleth seven times and rises up again. Now, my last point is this, and it'll be shorter. But the wicked shall fall into mischief. The wicked, talking about sinners, unbelievers, fools. Is that what you want on your gravestone, on your stone, on your tombstone? Fool, sinner. Is that what you want on there? Is that what you want to be known as? Is that what you want them to write? Oh, you say they'll write something lovely and peaceful and kind and good. But in everybody's heart, they're going to say, I know who he really was. What do people think about you? If it's what you're known as now, one of these bad things, don't you want something better? If you're known as the wicked, if you're lost in this world, if you're a sinner, if you don't know the Lord, okay? If you don't know Christ and salvation, if you don't become his child, then the wicked, that's going to be your name. That's what God calls you. And it'll only be, did you know it will only be until the end of your life that you'll be called the wicked? You know why? You say, that sounds like a good thing. No. The reason is because once you're dead, even that title will be forgotten. you will be forgotten by everyone forever. Proverbs says the memory or the name of the wicked shall rot. In Psalms 34:16, the Bible says, the face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. So the wicked, if you are the wicked, if you are, you say, well, I'm not that wicked. If you're not saved, God calls you the wicked. Okay, the wicked, now the next word there in that verse is shall. The word shall is a promise. God makes promises in the Bible. He often uses the word shall in his promise. When he says shall, he means it. Okay, when God promises something, he always keeps his promise. So if he calls you the wicked and he says you shall fall into mischief, he means it. Now, if you're alive and breathing, you have a way out. You can still turn to him and say, I don't want to be called the wicked no more. I don't want to be wicked no more. I am wicked. But I want to be, I want your righteousness. I want cleansing and forgiveness. And he'll do it. Okay. But the wicked shall, that's a promise. And then the third thing is fall. The wicked shall fall. Now there's falling down. There's falling into sin, falling into temptation, into utter wickedness, and falling at the mercy of the consequences of your sin and wickedness that will eventually destroy you. Okay, so there's falling down. We already talked about that, so we ain't going to talk much about it again. But if you're wicked, you shall fall sooner or later. Okay, and if you fall into these sins and these wicked things, they're going to destroy you. They're going to catch up with you sooner or later. Okay, but they will destroy you physically and all of that on this earth. But the last part of that verse says, they shall fall into mischief. Now, that word mischief, it means evil. You fall into evil. Into an evil place, fall into hurt, into bad trouble, fall into affliction, into calamity, into sorrow, and fall into distress, into injury. In other words, you know what it's saying? It's saying you're going to fall, the wicked shall, it's a promise, fall into the worst possible thing. What is the worst possible thing you can think of? Hell, that lake of fire, that bottomless pit. It's bottomless because there's going to be a continual falling. Can you imagine falling forever? Think in your mind. You've had one of those dreams. You've had lots of them probably. That you dream, that you, step off of something, off of a cliff or off of a building or something, and you fall. And it's so scary. And right about the time you hit the ground, you'll wake up. Falling is a scary thing. It's one of the torments of hell. The wicked shall fall into mischief. So whether you're an upstanding and good-natured and caring and moral person, or you're a hardened criminal or a murderer, you shall fall into mischief. Okay? It's a given. God calls you wicked. God calls you wicked if you've sinned and haven't gotten his forgiveness and salvation yet. And all the wicked will fall into mischief. The wicked, sometimes, it might seem, are blessed. Have you ever noticed? Here's these church-going people, upright, righteous, godly, God-filled people, and they seem to have problem after problem after problem after problem. And everything goes wrong, and they deal with stuff, and they face stuff all the time, and they trust God, and they strive and struggle to get through it. But here's these wicked people that do the worst of things. They seem to live fat and happy and at ease, and everything, you know, seems to go right. And, you know, sometimes the wicked, at times, they might seem like they're blessed, okay? Like they always bounce back, like they always get right back up and everything's fine again. Seems like some of them have no problems or hardships. Even in death, sometimes seem like they die with a smile on their face. We can't figure that out, and we can't understand it. David had went through this struggle, I think in Psalm 73, where he said he was just troubled at the prosperity of the wicked and these rich men that died in their fatness and happiness. But he said, I understood when I went to the sanctuary to their funeral, how that they had always been on slippery places, and that their feet finally slipped. See, when your feet slip, you end up falling. And what he's talking about is hell. He realized that they had it in this life, that was the most of heaven they was ever going to have. And when they died, they slipped off and fell into hell. That's what he's saying. So make no mistake, by looking on the temporal or the temporary, the outward, seeing these people that are prosperous, there's a bottomless pit awaiting them. In fact, the Bible says it moves to meet them at their coming. Isaiah 5:14 says, therefore hell hath enlarged herself and opened her mouth without measure, and their glory and their multitude and their pomp, and he that rejoiceth shall descend into it. The wicked shall fall into mischief. So either you're called the just because you've been saved, and that either means you're saved and you're serving God and giving him all your heart, or you're saved and you're not doing anything for him, but you're still called the just and you'll still make it to heaven. Or you're called the wicked because you know not God. So Christian, just man, woman, boy, girl, if you've fallen, if you've quit, if you've stopped serving God, get up. There's a cloud of witnesses screaming and cheering you on. And then what are you doing? Get up, get up, get up, get up. Finish the race. Don't quit. Don't stop. Keep going. They're cheering you on. Keep going. Get back up. Get back in the race. It's like the movie called Iron Will. It's kind of an old Disney thing about this boy that went and run a sled dog race up in Canada and down into America, and he was just a teenage boy, but he makes it all the way to the finish line ahead of everybody, and like 100 feet from the finish line, he stumbles and the thing turns over, and then here comes the ones that are behind him catching up with him, and they're coming fast, and everyone is yelling, get up, get up, come on, go again, finish the race, don't quit. And he's so tired and he's so exhausted and he's so beat down and his lips are cracked and bleeding and he's just a mess. But he's got to get back up and go again, and everybody's cheering him on to get up. Some witnesses, some people that are watching you run your race, they're your family or your friends, and they're begging you, get up. Get up, because I need you to pick me up. I've gotten away from the Lord. Or they're begging you, please get up. I know I've kicked you down, and then I've kicked you when you were down, and I was relentless and merciless and mean and hateful to you, and I was unkind. But it's because I don't know Jesus that you claim to know. And I need you to get up and overcome and finish the race and show me the one that can't be beaten no matter what. And show me what a real Christian is. If you're a Christian, I beg you, I urge you, get up and go again if you've quit. If you're lost, you don't have to be lost forever. find this Jesus who will pick you up out of the filthy muck and mire of sin that you're drowning in. And he'll set your feet on the track to righteousness and heaven, and he'll get you going, and he'll run the race with you, right alongside you or in front of you, clearing the way. The just man falleth seven times and rises up again, but the wicked fall into mischief. Which one are you? The just that's serving God and running the race? The just that isn't running the race, you've quit? Or the wicked? Which one are you? Let's go to the Lord in prayer this evening. Our dear Father, Lord, I pray that this message has helped somebody. Lord, I know I don't feel like I do a very good job many times, but I want to be faithful to you. And I pray that you would bless those who have heard and anyone who needed this message, that you'd help them to get back up and go again. Anyone who is lost and isn't saved, God, may you help them to know that and see and understand that there's a whole lot better life in Christ Jesus than there is living in fear of death and knowing that after death is a hopeless eternity where there's no more chance, a place of falling and falling into misery and pain. And pray, God, that you just save that one who needs salvation and encourage and uplift that one who needs to get back up. And for those of us who are trying to run the race, help us to stay faithful and not ever quit. Bless now and go with us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I'm going to sign off. Thank you for joining us today. Let me turn this off. Appreciate it. And if you need anything, we do want to ask you, send me post or text or whatever. Send me any prayer requests that you have. We'll be glad to pray for you and encourage y'all to pray for each other. But until then, we'll see you next time on Sunday. God bless. Merry Christmas.